Okay. You know, I have to admit, it feels somewhat superfluous to introduce Rocco Commisso to a room full of cable operators. I mean, is there anybody who doesn't know him or of him? I sort of thought, gee, it's sort of like introducing the bishop to a room full of priests. You know, I mean, you all know him. You know what he's done. He's done a terrific job. But by way of introduction, I'll go kind of easy on that. Rocco is one of the most successful Italian-American immigrants, entrepreneurs in our U.S. history. Remarkable, it came here when he was 12 years old and created a remarkable company. So his cable career spans more than just the 20 years of Mediacom, but more than 37 years. He's chairman and CEO of Mediacom, which he started in 1995 to acquire and reinvigorate underserved smaller communities, which he certainly has done. He did a little flip-flop since we're in Washington. He took his company public in 2000, and then in 2011, he took it back private again in a very interesting experience there, but all in the process of becoming the eighth largest cable provider in the United States, 4,600 employees, 1.3 million subs in 22 states, revenue that's closing in on $2 billion, and wholly owned by Rocco and his family. So, Rocco, thank you so much for coming. It's a pleasure to have you here. A couple things. First, I know that this is a big year for you. It's the 20th anniversary of the founding of buying the first system in California,
Ridgecrest, California, right?
which is terrific. But I'd like to start off. What was before Mediacom?
Nothing.
Well, no. What did you do before Mediacom?
So let me give a little bit of. Well, I worked in banking, lending money to, the great small then but big today entrepreneurs in the cable business. I fell in love. I was in a group called Communications and Entertainment. First at Chase Manhattan Bank, which is now J.P. Morgan, then Royal Bank of Canada. Started a group lending money to these sub-industry groups. And of all of them, I decided to specialize or fall in love with and passionately in love with, the cable industry. Even then, I saw something that I didn't see in everything else, in the other subsectors. And thank God that I did that. In 86, Alan Gary, another great entrepreneur, asked me to go and serve as a CFO. We took the company from, the 28th largest, and within 9 years, we made it the eighth largest company. And in 1995, I don't know if you guys remember those days, barely 3 years after our great government decided to regulate our business in 1992,
yep.
Follow up with a 17% by Reed Hunt. You remember Reed Hunt?
Yep.
It scared a lot of people that were been in the business for a long time and frankly made the decision that he wants to get out of the business. I was still, and today I'm the same, a very strong believer in the business, a contrarian. My feeling then was, that regulation, whatever was bad, the regulatory front's gonna change at some point in time. There was a huge oversupply of small market systems, and the bigger companies like Comcast were dedicating all their resources to the major markets, and was a confluence of factors that led me to, feel strongly that I could buy small market cable systems at a very reasonable price, which we did. So that's 1995. We bought our first system exactly 20 years ago in Richfield, California. The first system, the second system, the third system did not do very well, okay? But since I used to do one every 3 months, so one every 6 months, the banks never got to test whether my projections were ever gonna be met. So it led to 1999. I'll never forget the day. We did a major deal with Cablevision Systems, which is getting sold as we speak to Altice in 1997. And that was right before, at a phenomenal price, right before Comcast or Microsoft, if anybody wasn't in the business at that time, made a $1 billion investment to Comcast where things started taking off. But even then, I was able in 1999, all through private money that I raised and bank financings, you know, to still be able to do another deal, which was Triax. And it's just an amazing story that in November 1999, I'm buying the Triax systems. And then in February 2000, immediately after, the Time Warner AOL, do anybody remembers that deal that announced, right?
Yeah.
I go out and take the company public. And we bought systems on a weighted average basis at $1,700 a sub, and 3 months later we sold them to the markets at $3,400 a sub. Now, for anyone that is financially knowledgeable about, you know, how things get valued, traded, and sold and bought, we took our company public at 18 times cash flow. Is that a good number, right?
Yeah.
I think it's a good number, right? Thank God for those days. So they gave me the money, took the company public, and then, Bob, you know, the next big deal was in 2001, where we bought another half of our company, which we call the AT&T acquisition. We did about 25 acquisitions from 96 to 2001, and then we stopped, thank God. Immediately after the AT&T acquisitions, we were leveraged 8.8 times. Right. Now, for anybody that's ever borrowed money, that's pretty damn high.
Yeah, it is.
Right?
Yep.
And the reason why we're still around is because we stopped buying. The stock never saw its high of $19 ever again. It started going down. And we begin then. I had the B stock. I always retained control of the company. That was critical that I never, in all the time that I raised capital, that I never give control 21 hours other than me. Okay, I wanted to make sure if somebody's going to kick me out of a job, it's going to be me, as opposed to somebody else. So whether during the period that I was private, between 96 and 2000, and the period that we were public from 2000 to 2011, from 2000 to 2011, right, 11 years, you know, I always managed, even though I didn't own the whole company, I always managed to retain control of the company. And then, and I'll get into that later, I'm sure you have a lot of other questions, but in 2011, well, we announced in 2010 that we're going to take the company private. My stock was trading at $5. You know, we had something like, if you look at the enterprise value, equity, and debt, we had something like 95% debt and 5% of equity value, which most people would say that's very leveraged, right, from a debt to equity. So it didn't cost much to buy back the public. You know, I forewarned, and if anybody here from Wall Street or from the trade, they know full well that I gave them plenty of opportunity to raise the price up. I mean, my public stockholders, they didn't listen to me once. They didn't listen to me the second time. By the third time, I said, I ain't gonna make a move here because I'm sick of this stuff. So at the time that Comcast and Time Warner were trading at about five and a half times, you know, we essentially took the company public. It was trading at 6.5 times and 7 times. And actually, we'll get into the past five years. And it's been an absolutely phenomenal success because I now own, you know, together with my family, 100% of the company. Yeah.
That's terrific. Terrific story. Is there, I mean, there's such a long, colorful history and so many events in there. Is there one that's like a favorite memory or a most memorable event in the history of Mediacom for you?
So since we're all small operators, I view myself as starting small, maybe a little bigger than most people here, but I'm still small. So there's a good one. So we're negotiating with AT&T. AT&T needs money to go out, and because they promised S&P that they will get X amount of dollars. You know, our AT&T acquisition cost us $2.1 billion, 2.2. And they needed that money by the month of June, okay, so that they don't get downgraded by S&P. So here we are, you know, I put the systems on the market. I had just done all kinds of other acquisitions, but this great opportunity came around. And in February 28th of 2001, AT&T said, Rocco, you got to put $100 million at risk if you want these assets. And if you don't give us the money by the end of June, you know, you're going to lose $100 million. Oh, I say, holy shit. First of all, where am I going to find $100 million, right? And then should I take that risk? Because, well, you know, it's pretty sizable, $2.2 billion. So I said, well, I'm a risk taker. Why don't we do it? In 4 months, now, I want you to compare this, by the way, what's going on with Time Warner, Comcast, and so on. These guys are taking a year, year and a half to get their deal done. I have 4 months to get 800,000 customers, you know, 300 franchise transfers in four different states, and raise capital all over the world in four different markets. The debt market, the bank market, the high yield market, the equity market, and the convertible market. Well, I did. But I did it for a different reason, you know, that why AT&T wanted me to do it. I knew, those guys didn't know, right? At AT&T, I knew that given the subscriber definition and the ups and downs that I would pay less if they deliver less subscribers, I would pay more if they gave me more subscribers. I knew, but they didn't know, that in the month of June, they're gonna lose 50,000 students. You got that? Right? So that was part of the definition. The big shots at AT&T, they didn't know anything, you know, other than the fact that they needed their money. So the definition of the contract was, you know, for every subscriber that you give me less at the day of closing, which was the month of June, I would pay $3,000 less, which I did. That little thing in the contract saved me $150 million. So the $100 million risk that I took, I made it up with $150 million I made on them by taking that risk. That's pretty good business, right?
That's great. So one of the things you mentioned, that when you worked at Royal Bank of Canada and Chase Manhattan, you helped arrange financing for a lot of cable companies. You mentioned Alan Gary and others.
John Malone. Well, John Regan, a lot of people. Yeah.
They're virtually all gone from their companies now. You might be the only one of that school from the last 20 years or so. What has kept you in?
Well, first of all, I don't have anything better to do, all right? two, it's my people and my family. I think, okay. You know, I have a... I think if you were to ask any of my people, they'd say, Rocco, we want you to work for you and not nobody else, all right? Three, it's not for lack of choice. Four, you know, it's because we have a strong business. You know, I was thinking coming down here, you know, and given where I started, you know, Mediacom, and we're not a big company, but Mediacom is bigger than the New York Times. What's that big newspaper in Chicago? The Chicago Tribune.
Yep.
The Los Angeles
Times.
Yep. The Wall Street Journal. Now, well, the Wall Street Journal, I'll leave it on the side. Okay, the Washington Post, you combine, and another 10 newspapers, whatever McCall and Knight Ridder used to own. You know, we have a greater market value than them. The radio business, which I used to lend money to, is gone, right? The two largest companies almost bankrupt. The magazine business, you know, they wish they had gone a long time ago. Look what happened to Time Inc., right, or the Time Magazine. The telecom business, if it wasn't for all the mergers that they would have done in the last 20 years, you know, God knows, you know, the big Ma Bell was split up in 84. Now they're back together in the form of Verizon, right? It's wireless that saved them. So of all those sub-sectors of the business that I used to lend money, which one is over a long, long period of time has been resilient, strong, and we always seem to come up with a new gig? It's the cable business. So it is a great business, thank God, that I chose, and it's still a great business today.
Well, thank you. Now, the panel is supposed to be about success in the marketplace, and obviously Mediacom has been very successful marched forward. And I looked at some stats that in the last dozen years, your PSUs have increased from 1.8 million to Right, from 1.8 to 2.4.
Right.
And your revenues have increased from 900 million to almost doubled to 1.7, 1.8 billion. During a period of time when your TV subs, which was in the beginning was your base, declined by like 45%. So obviously there are a lot of challenges there. And your goal was originally to revitalize systems that had been left to deteriorate pretty significantly. There were a lot of challenges there. So what do you think were the critical decisions that enabled you to complete that successfully? I mean, what were the pivotal issues that you think you had to deal with? Was it people? Was it financing? Was it capital? Was it the improvement? Was it products and services? I mean, you faced all the same issues everybody here faces, but you did it on a much larger scale. What was critical that led to you being able to maintain your success?
It starts with our people, and I think I'm blessed, frankly, to have a management team that's probably the most tenured among the major companies. I can't speak for the smaller companies in the business. You know, I was kidding around with Brian Roberts a year ago. I said, shit, you know, in the same time that you have had four CFOs, I've had one, right? I mean, we have, I don't know, 200-300 years of experience just among the top 10 people in our company. So it starts with our people. It starts with going to work every day, right? I tell my people that you could go and rent a plane to go around the systems. I'm flying commercial to come to Washington, including today, all right? So there's certain things that are critical to make sure that you set the right example. You know, we have been blessed, or good, of being able to borrow, I think, between financings, initial financings, refinancings, and a number of capital markets. You know, we probably both here at Mediacom and, you know, and my 9 years at Cablevision, 30 years of borrowing experience. I must have borrowed, what, $20 billion between financings, new financings. Today we got $3 billion of debt. You know, I don't think there's another company as leveraged as we have been with the credit ratings, low credit ratings that we have had in the world or in America, or in our sector, outside of our sector. They could say, I've spent 30 years borrowing money and never had a financial default in my entire career, okay? That's a pretty, nah, what does that do to you? What that does, it gives you credibility. It gives you the ability, as long as you meet the numbers, as long as you pay your bills, you know that there's the financial side of the equation. You know, it's always there for you when you need them, all right? That's number one. Two, you know, despite the fact that we have lost all kinds of video customers, like 45% of our initial base, you know, in the last 14 years, you know, we made it up with the broadband business. We made it up by launching the phone business. We made it up by aggressively going after the business services business. And today, it is true, we almost have doubled the revenues than we had when we just had 1.6 million video customers and 100,000 data customers. Three, you know, we didn't hold back in spending money in our infrastructure. We spent $3.6 billion to acquire everything that we have acquired, you know, back in the first 6 years. But we also spent an additional $4.2 billion, that's almost $8 billion, okay, to invest and reinvest and reinvest. I don't know if you noticed, but we were one of the first companies, if not the first company, to go on record that we launched the 105 meg service back 3 or 4 years ago, all right? We went out and in our network, which when we bought and inherited the systems that we bought, we had over 700 head ends. Today we got one, actually we have two. One is a replacement for the first one in case it goes down, all right? But just think about it, with one head end, you know, we service, you know, customers in 22 states. Three. You know, we are laid down on the ground, 600,000 strand miles of fiber, okay, where 15 years ago there was none. Any new technologies, any new improvement, any uplift on the broadband side, you know, we have done it all. I'm sure you've done it in your company, and we have done the same thing. I mean, our standard product today is 50, 100, 150 megs, and pretty soon the 1 gig, right? And we've always been at the upfront, even though I've lost my customers, and you know who's to be blamed. We'll get into that subject,
yep,
right?
Yep.
It ain't Robert
yep.
to be blamed for that. It's somebody else, and we'll get into that, all right? But even though I lost all the customers that we had, Mediacom has never had a down year of revenues. And we have only had in 20 years one down year of cash flow growth, one down year, 1%, all because I got hit with three hurricanes back to back in 2004 and 2005. In fact, if you look at the last 10 years, and I'm aware of the numbers, you know, whether it's Bright House, Cablevision, Time Warner, Cox, Charter was bankrupt and came to life again, right? Mm-hmm. Among the largest companies, with the exception of Comcast, I probably have the steadiest, you know, cash flow growth of any other company out there among the larger companies. You know, that says something about, you know, this, one, the strength of the business, two, the hard work that we do as a company, and three is, the, you know, forecasting for the future and making sure that you watch the store on a daily basis. You know, and that's what I do every day.
Terrific, thank you. Now, in addition to being an activist for your company and promoting that so hard, you've also been an advocate for the entire cable industry, and you speak out frequently about policies that really sort of fail to note our industry's investment in broadband and television and bringing competition to phone, and at the same time, those policies seem to overlook the abuses of content companies and tech companies. And I'm curious, why do you think policymakers have this negative perception? And if we have that, how can we correct it to, I guess, to receive the credit we deserve for the investments that we've made?
Well, let's start out with that guy, what's his name? Al Gore, remember, anybody remembers Al Gore back in 1990?
He invented the internet, right?
You'll remember him, right? This is the same guy, by the way, that after he left government, he was hustling me to see if I want to launch Al Jazeera, right? Was owned by a foreign, right? At the same time, it was negotiating to get the hell out of the business, all right? This goes to show you what kind of principled people we have, all right? So we got screwed big time in 1992, we as an industry, and it started from there. So we've been regular now, what, 25 years? Right? Mm-hmm. And nothing that we do seems to convince the politicians that we are a company that at the end of the day has made huge investments in America, okay? Retains or hires people that live in the communities where we operate, right? We
don't outsource, right?
We don't send our business out to Mexico or whatever, or China. What does Trump say these days? Mexico, China, you know, taking advantage of us. We keep employment in the community. We pay big tax bills, right? Yep. I mean, just my bill in the state of Iowa, by the way, is $50 million a year, okay? Between fees, franchise fees, taxes, property tax, and so on. Yep. And then I have to see that Google and Apple, IBM, and Facebook comes into the state of Iowa, and the state of Iowa gives them $150 million just to bring them in. God, I increased for no employment increase because it's data centers and so on. I've increased the employment base in the state of Iowa by 600 people, you know, in the last 10 years. I've paid them $50 million a year in taxes, which is what, 10 years average? Yeah. I've been there 15 years, $600-$700 million. I've invested just in the state of Iowa $1.7 billion, and not once did Rocco's ask for a penny from the government. I get criticized, those guys are the good people. Right. So why are they the good people and we're the bad people?
That's the question. What do you think?
Don't let this, don't underestimate this point. We are a successful industry, okay? Two, we unfortunately are the ones that send the bills out to the customer, okay? We send the bill, we collect the money, and we give it away to those people that are screwing us, all right? Our cable bill, when we got regulated back in 1992, you know, it was $23 with a programming cost of $4.50. I remember those numbers. Today, you know, we made our cost to the consumer might have tripled, right? Fair enough. Yeah, but the programming cost has gone from $4.50 to $45, That's tenfold. Does anybody ever talk about that? Yeah. Now, $45 times 12 is 600 times 100 million. That's a $60 billion remittance, you know, that our industry,
right.
you know, including the satellites, makes to the programming community. Yeah. They're the good people with the bad people. They just see the recent list of billionaires in America. You know, look at the sports teams and see what they're worth. And who do you think they made them valuable? It's us, the cable business, and our customers that made them valuable because we pay for these stupid RCNs when they should be a la carte, okay? So my mother should not be paying for the Yankees because she doesn't even, she's 95, by the way. She still doesn't even know how to spell baseball, say what baseball's all about. All right? But the YES Network has to be on basic cable as opposed to an a la carte service, all right? I could go on and on and on. Look, you know, it's political. It's a question who takes care of which political party takes care of it. And I thought I was finished with dealing with this baloney, right? But now we got Silicon Valley that's coming after us, right? Mm-hmm. Yep. So we start with, right, which is what the set-top box is and yep. all this other stuff. You know, I was telling somebody, and they don't seem to understand that until you explain it. You know, I give a seminar at Columbia, with Columbia University, which is my school. It's Obama's school, too, by the way, all right? So
we won't hold that against you.
Right. And so it's a combined business school and law class that I give seminars. And I, yeah, these are some of the smartest kids in America. I ask them, so when I go in, you know, I ask, how many do you think I'm a monopolist? You know, 50% of the people think I'm a monopolist. Nobody knows that every franchise that we have is non-exclusive.
Yeah.
Nobody understands why there's not three or four people with the Y under the home. Because they think we're a monopoly, that's the reason why they don't go the next step and say, you know, maybe there's not four wires because it costs a lot of money. And if you, in a capital intensive business, which we are, if you spread out the customer base among four different wires that cost the same thing, nobody's gonna make money. And people don't get into the business world to lose money. Yeah.
Well, you know what, I always find it really funny when an angry customer calls you a monopolist and threatens to go to your competition in the same sentence. I mean, it happens all the time. You're a monopolist. I'm so mad I'm going to switch. So
well, look at our situation. You know, we started out 20 years ago with 67, 70% pay penetration, right, to homes passed. Today we're 31%, you know. I wish I was a monopolist. Then I wouldn't have lost the customers.
Then everybody would have to have your service. So, well, let me ask you. We've all been talking about internet as our future. We're all focused on broadband, but we kind of keep getting sucked back in to the television side of things with retransmission consent, set-top box, program access, and so forth. I'm just curious, from your perspective, is linear television too far gone? I mean, is it beyond saving at this point? Is it on a trajectory that the costs are on that, you know, compound interest rates is just going to push our costs to over $100 a month per basic customer in 5 years? Is it affordable to people in your service areas? Is there anything we can do to stop that trajectory and regain control of it?
Look, I mean, it's not for lack of speaking. It's not for lack of filings at the FCC. It's not for lack of opinion papers that we have each wrote in the newspapers, not for lack of getting shut down. How many times did I get shut down? Sinclair, you know, they're all my friends, by the way, right? They call you on the phone and say, why don't we double the price this year? Why don't we triple next year, you know? You know, God forbid, it should be a 5% increase. Double, you know. Actually, they start with a triple figure. Yeah, if they, you know, if we negotiate it down to a double or, you know, one, double and a half, you know, it's a good deal for me, right? I mean, it's just amazing that this great government of us, and I put Congress and I put the FCC in the same boat, okay? You know, they know this issue. It's not that they don't know. They know exactly what's happening, you know, but they come to us and say, it's your fault, Rocco, it's your fault, Bob, it's, you know, and you have the blame. And they don't fix what is really the problem driving up the cost of pay TV for the American consumer. Now, is this gonna change? I thought it would have changed by now. Right. You know, how the hell could you rationalize regulating us, you know, when our price at $23 and nowadays $75 is okay, right? No, you know, frankly, no, very few people talk about video services being very expensive in government. What they're talking about now is that we shouldn't be charging for the boxes, right? Yeah. Now, let me get into the boxes, if you don't mind.
Go ahead, right? Sure.
So I asked my people, I don't know everything, but you know, what the government just said, 185%, remember the 185% they threw out, you know, over the last 20 years, video, the set-top box is going up by 185%. All right, let's take that as a given, okay? That means if I did my numbers right, and I'm gonna do round numbers so everyone understands, it's $2.50 that we charged 20 years ago per box to $7.50. It's a $5 increase. Everybody's got that, right? Yep. So let's take that $5 here, all right? Now, wouldn't it be easy, and now programming costs went from $5 to $45. That's $40. What would be easier to fix? The $40 increase, okay, on the video side, or the damn $5 increase on the box side? Number one. Number two, you know, it cost me $250 for the box that I give to the consumer. You know, 20 years ago it was $50. Yeah. Okay, we had a what kind of a box was an analog box?
Yep, with a slide bar on top. Yeah,
right. You know better than me. I'm not an old boy.
Oh yeah.
Right.
Yep.
Right. We have a computer in the house now.
Yeah.
Go forward, go backwards, DVR, HD. You know, video on demand. How could you compare one with the other? Yeah. Right. But they never say that. Right.
And you know, the point I bring up about that more recently is how much does the data cost on that $7.50 box every month?
Right.
We're all paying Rovi, you know, $1.50, $2 or more every month, and nobody ever thinks about that cost.
Right.
We didn't have that 20 years ago. It was a 10-cent cost.
I've been wrong. I've been a failure. We always call it a failure. I figure with my loud mouth and the fact that I'm willing to stand up for my people, my company, my industry, you know, all the way up to when I did what I did a year ago when Obama came into my market, right? And I went on C-SPAN, I wrote a nice memo, said, I dare you come to Iowa and call me a monopolist. In a town that was a monopoly for sewer, gas, electricity, right? It was a municipal overbill. I went crazy over that. He didn't write, he didn't say anything, he didn't come back to Cedar Falls anymore, right? but how dare you come to the state of Iowa that elected you and you don't have anything good to say about my people, okay? How dare could you demean, you know, my company and what we have done in the state of Iowa with all those investments that we have made? So look, you know, I don't care who it is, you know. When I feel I'm right, I will speak up, and but I failed at the end of the day. We have failed, you know, and I can't, you know, I guess the only good that comes out of this thing is that, you know, the other industries that I mentioned have bigger problems than we do. Because we're still around, they're
right.
Not.
Yep. Well, Rocco, the screen is flashing at us here, and I'll just say, you and what you just said, you and your loud mouth are welcome back here anytime. Love having you. We really appreciate Mediacom.
Thank you. Yep.
Thanks, Rocco. I really appreciate it.
That was great.
It was terrific. But thank you for all the hard work of Mediacom.
Enjoyed it, all right?